Welcome to the Dork Forest. Jackie and her pals will never bore us. Shameless confessions
about our obsessions
will make us laugh and smile. So let's explore the Dork Forest and dork out for a while.
Hi, it's Jackie Cation. Welcome to the Dork Forest. You know the websites, JackieCation.com, DorkForest.com, TheDorkForest.com. Oh, I bought FamilyPetAncestry.com, too, because I wrote a joke about it. It made me laugh. So if you go to FamilyPetAncestry.com, it really brings you to JackieCation.com. There's a million things you can do about the show. The show, of course, streaming on those websites, and then also on iTunes and probably Stitcher, because I think they just take it and then repurpose it. I don't get those numbers. I'm sure a million people are listening on Stitcher, and I'll never know. And that's fine. I don't care. AllThingsComedy.com is my podcast umbrella hosty kind of people. Al Madrigal, Bill Burr, Tom Papa, Aaron Foley, Baron Vaughn, bunch of people that are Bert Kreischer. There's a lot of pods there if you're looking for pods. If you want to talk to other rangers of the Dork Forest, that is the Ranger page on Facebook. You can follow me, Jackie Cation, on Twitter. And the show also has a Twitter account, but that's mostly just the Periscope account because I didn't know what I was doing with Periscope. And I'm doing very little. But at Jackie Cation is Twitter and Instagram at, I think it's TDF Podcast. I don't know what it is for the Periscope account. And then on the Libsyn page, there's always a phone bonus. It's if you get the app, you get the phone bonus automatically. And it used to, you had to have the app. But now Libsyn just puts it up there and has for 150 episodes. So if you want to listen to Andy Ashcraft and myself discuss the show, there's a little phone bonus, like 2 or 3 minutes of just me and him talking about what the show's going to be like. And you can go to tdf.libsyn.com, I think it is. Okay, the credits, for God's sake, the people who put it together. Patrick Brady's going to fix this audio. Thank you. Mike Rickberg composed and sang that intro song that you just heard. He will sing his words to the Mexican hat dance at the end of the program. And Vilmos redoes my website. Speaking of the website, he is redoing my website, the merch page in particular. So get in now, because I think soon all the prices are going to go up on the t-shirts. Not on the CDs, I don't think, or the DVD. But you can buy all kinds of stuff for the Dork Forest and for my stand-up on JackieCation.com at the store. But postage went up a whole bunch, and they're all union-made, U.S.-made t-shirts. So they're heavier than normal. I don't know. So everything's going to be $30. That includes the postage, and I think it's $35 if you're ordering internationally. Hello, England. Hello, Australia. Hello, Germany and Thailand and Japan. What else? The donate button. For the love of God, donate. I don't have any work. I forgot to book work, and then it's too late to book work, so I don't have any work. So if you enjoy the show and you have been donating, I totally appreciate it. But if you haven't donated, now's the time. Now's the time to get in. Get in on the donating. Feel free to throw me some money, because it would be great. And if you can't, afford merch or the donation button, you can always use the Amazon button. The Amazon banner on JackieCation.com just goes right to Amazon, and then you just order normal from Amazon. And then there's some sort of associate program that helps out the show. Other than that, I'm doing a lot of stand-up here in Los Angeles. And then this week, I'm doing a weird casino outside of Ashland, Wisconsin, because that's how little work I have. I was like, sure, I'll spend all of my money on airfare and renting a car and drive to an Indian casino 15 minutes from Lake Superior to make a couple $100. Let's do it. So feel free to donate, I guess is what I'm saying. But this is an amazing episode because it's about to start. Hey, it's Jackie Cation. I'm in one of those rooms in Minneapolis at the Town Suites doing Dork Forests, because that's what's happening. I'm featuring this week at Acme. It is in the middle of July sometime, and I'm here sitting with the other half of the vice presidential duo, Matthew Saxe. Welcome to the program.
Thanks. Thanks for having me. I'm thrilled.
It was awesome. Super fun. It was Jason Klom was so funny about the whole thing because he kept saying your name. And I was like, fine, let's get Matt on. Let's do that. And he's like, you should totally have Matt on. You're going to Minneapolis, right? So here we are.
Yeah, now, perfect timing.
Yes. So Matthew Saxe, you are on Twitter at VP Matt Saxe, S-A-X-E. And you have a theater company here in Minneapolis called Shadow Horse Theater.
That's right.
ShadowHorseTheater.com. Links to all the Facebook groups that you're part of and all the improv troupes and the theater itself and all this stuff. And their Twitter feed and all that.
Yes.
So people can go check that out. Now, I have to say I'm fascinated about vice presidents only because I don't know anything about them.
Sure. No one does. So you're not alone.
Right. I think I told Jason this, is that my brother Russ once memorized all of the Supreme Court justices.
Oh, my God.
For no reason.
Not all of them. Not just like the Chief Justice, but all of them?
Through history.
Oh, my God.
Like every court he wanted to know. And I was like, you know what? Now that I say that out loud, I wonder if it were all the Secretaries of State. I think it was which would have been easier since there's only one at a time.
That would be a little easier, yeah.
Yeah, because there's not a dozen people involved.
No.
Every 20 years.
Yeah, all those courts with all those rotating, judges and everything.
I wonder how many I need. All right, putting it out there, you guys. I need a Supreme Court. I did have, actually from Minneapolis, Clee Wiggin, no? Whatever, was on talking about the Supreme Court, and I didn't have the right questions. Sometimes I don't have the right questions about the dorkdom. And I'm a huge fan when someone just goes in some direction.
Sure.
So let's go Minnesota vice presidents first.
Well, you're in a good place for it, and that's a good state. Minnesota has had two very powerful and influential vice presidents.
Are they the only vice presidents that we've
from Minnesota?
From
yes.
Minnesota.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're Hubert Humphrey.
Okay. Who was he vice president for?
He was vice president under Lyndon Johnson.
That's right. Okay.
After Johnson
I vaguely remember
ran
that.
When Johnson ran in 64, you know, he didn't have a vice president for the first 9 months of his presidency after the Kennedy assassination.
Oh, right.
So there was no VP at that time. Then he chose Humphrey as his running mate.
And that's right. It's an appointed position, right?
And
then confirmed?
It's appointed. It can be in the case of when Nixon's vice president Spiro Agnew resigned.
Yeah.
You know, he submitted Gerald Ford. He nominated him, and he had to be approved by the Senate and everything.
Right.
But in this case, in 64, since Johnson was the sitting president, you know, he had to choose a running mate to run with him in 64.
Oh, okay.
And he chose Humphrey, who had been his when LBJ ran the Senate pretty much for 20 years.
Yeah.
Humphrey was his second in command. He was who he used to do lots of his legwork and everything.
Oh, okay.
So they were they came in together in 48 in the Senate, and they worked together all that time. And
Humphrey's from Minnesota.
Humphrey's from here. He had been mayor of Minneapolis.
Oh, wow.
And yeah, he'd been one of the greatest mayors in Minneapolis history. He'd been elected mayor when he was about 36, 37 years old. He was a young mayor.
During the Depression? Or?
Yeah. He helped stamp out some of the organized crime that was here, like the gangsters in St. Paul and bootlegging and stuff.
Okay.
He'd been a prosecutor, and then he was mayor of Minneapolis. Mm-hmm. And then he'd been selected by the DNC, the Democratic National Committee, to speak at the 48 convention with Truman, where everyone thought Truman was going to get stomped by Thomas Dewey.
Right.
And Humphrey gave a very powerful pro-civil rights speech that made the Mississippi and Alabama delegates and other Southern delegates walk out. And it created the schism that led to Strom Thurmond getting the Dixiecrat nomination and led to there being four candidates in the 48 election, which is one of the most fascinating and interesting elections in presidential history, because it had Truman as the Democrat and sitting president.
Right.
Who was the accidental president after, FDR's death.
Yep.
Then Dewey was the establishment Republican candidate.
Okay.
And he'd lost to FDR back in 44.
Okay.
And then you had Strom Thurmond, the Southern Dixiecrat candidate.
Okay.
For segregationists.
Right.
And then you had a former vice president, Henry Wallace, as the progressive communist candidate.
That's right. Who was...
And he'd been FDR's VP before Truman.
Before Truman. And I remember that just from the Roosevelt documentary.
Yeah.
So, the Ken Burns thing.
Right.
So Humphrey gave...
Electrifying speech, about saying that the Democratic Party was 137 years too far behind civil rights.
Okay.
And it was time to advance civil rights now, in 48.
Yeah.
And the Dixiecrats, the Southern Democrats, later becoming the Dixiecrats, they just stormed out. And some Southern delegate said, "Can you imagine the damn fool people in Minnesota sending that damn idiot to represent them here?"
Wow.
I mean, they were furious about it.
Yeah, wasn't a lot of cursing going on in quotes.
No.
So
he called him a damn fool. But Humphrey was right in endorsing it because he worked so hard with himself and others, northern mayors of cities like Chicago and Cleveland and everything, they rallied the black vote in those states, and that vote helped get Truman elected.
Okay,
The biggest upset in presidential election history.
That's the only thing I really remember from that election. So that's fascinating.
Yeah.
And then Truman, was that in his first elected and his only elected?
That was his only term that he won on his own, yeah.
Right, and that's when he desegregated the army, right?
And then that led to the desegregation of the army.
That's right, the armed forces. And then so that's Humphrey. And so Humphrey was his vice president, just that one.
Humphrey was vice president, no, for LBJ.
Oh, for LBJ, sorry about that.
No, yeah. Truman's vice president was different, a guy named Alvin Barkley from Kentucky.
My apologies.
Yeah, don't worry. But Humphrey made a big splash in 48.
Okay.
He'd been a very progressive and popular mayor of Minneapolis, and he's probably, with all due respect to our last mayor, R.T. Ryback, who's a nice guy who I've met a few times, Humphrey's probably the greatest mayor in Minneapolis history.
Okay.
And then he was elected to the Senate, and he came in with LBJ, and they became friends in the Senate, and they pushed together and pushed through a lot of powerful legislation.
Mm-hmm.
So when LBJ, you know, didn't appoint a vice president to finish out Kennedy's term after the Kennedy assassination, he needed a vice presidential candidate.
And a running mate, essentially,
Yeah, he needed a running mate. And pretty much everyone thought Humphrey was going to get it because he'd been very close with Johnson in the Senate. But Johnson, being like the kind of, you know, major league dick that he was, he kind of teased about it. You know,
he's kind of jerking him around.
Him around a lot. He jerked him around a lot. And
you know, the presidential episode with Brian Kiley, I found out that LBJ was supposedly very well endowed.
He was.
And and would sit around without any clothes on.
Oh, yeah.
Just so that other guys would see how big his dick was.
He'd do that. He'd, like, sit on the toilet, you know, taking a dump with his dick hanging out and talk conversations with them about policy in the toilet. He'd get out of the shower every morning, LBJ. I'll do this really quick. He'd get out of the shower, you know, and look down at his dick and say, like, all right, Jumbo, who are we going to fuck today?
Oh, Jesus. Well, he just sounds like a charmer.
He was a charming man. Yeah.
Yes.
So you can imagine how he treated, like, little Hubert Humphrey, who was a Minnesota, Minnesota nice guy. And also, you know, typical, like, dough-faced liberal, you know, as he was called the Happy Warrior. That was his nickname.
Right.
But
he probably had that sort of Norwegian kind of...
Yeah, he was a Norwegian, Swedish, you know, nice little man.
Yeah,
nice little guy. Like, he was like 5'6", 5'7".
Right.
Compared to LBJ, who was like 6'3", and towering and powerful. So he intimidated Humphrey a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, you know, it was pretty much... Everyone knew that Humphrey was going to be the VP candidate.
Okay.
But LBJ danced around it a little. He wouldn't say who he was going to do. And then he summoned Humphrey from, like, the Senate to the White House.
Yeah.
And made him sit out in a car for, like, I think, like, 4 or 6 hours or something waiting for him. And then Humphrey fell asleep in the car after it, like, circled Washington, like, taking him on a tour of Washington. He'd lived in Washington by that point for, like, 15, 16 years.
Mm-hmm.
So that was all just bullshit for him.
Right.
And then it sits there in the White House parking lot, and he's waiting and waiting, and he falls asleep.
Yeah.
And Johnson finally walks out and knocks on the window and wakes him up and scares him half to death.
Ugh.
And then says, if you didn't know you were going to be my VP candidate before this, you're too damn dumb to have the job.
Yeah.
And...
Great.
That's how he treated him, basically.
That's right. He's just like, he makes him do all these things and then makes fun of him for taking it.
Right. And then he thought Humphrey talked too much. Like, he'd limit his speeches. He'd say, you have this much time and that's it. And he'd tap at his watch like
where
Humphrey
light him?
Could see it.
He'd
yeah.
be like, wrap it up?
Wrap it up. He'd all wrap right. him up. And then Humphrey gave an electrifying speech at the 64 convention calling out Barry Goldwater about, like, all this stuff. Like, he'd say stuff like, you know, the rest of the Congress supported the Civil Rights Act.
Yeah.
But where was Senator Goldwater?
Yeah.
And, like, people caught on to it, and so the audience would chant back at him when he'd get to that, where was Senator Goldwater?
Oh, my God.
It was a really great speech, and he just had them in the palm of his hand.
Yeah.
And it electrified the whole convention. It ripped apart Barry Goldwater.
Mm-hmm.
And they won in a landslide, and that's what they – you know, the 64 election is the landslide Lyndon election where they – I think they won every state except, like, two or something like that.
Right.
Like Arizona, Barry Goldwater state, and some other conservative state.
Right.
And they ripped him apart.
Yeah.
And so Humphrey became VP, and in the Senate, he'd done a lot of great work. Like, he had been the guy who had come up with the concept and idea for the Peace Corps, which Kennedy had created. Yeah. He'd
which
push...
is a great way to invade a country peacefully.
Yes,
it's exactly. very nice.
But it's very subtle.
They do. It's very subtle, but they do build bridges and schools.
Yes. They do a lot of good stuff.
They really do.
And it was and Humphrey went into it with like totally altruistic goals.
Right. Right. Yeah.
Totally.
I think he was very much one of these noblesse kind of guys.
Oh yeah. And then when it came to the Civil Rights Act, Johnson entrusted Humphrey to steer it through the Senate.
Okay.
And Humphrey is who really got the Civil Rights Act through the Senate.
Okay.
Johnson did a lot of stuff, obviously, with phone calls, and there was a lot of wheeling and dealing. But it was Humphrey who he entrusted to push the Civil Rights Act through the Senate.
Yeah.
And without Hubert H. Humphrey, who'd been, like I said, in 48 talking about civil rights,
yeah,
there would have been no Civil Rights Act, and it wouldn't have gone through.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Because Johnson being such kind of a muscle guy and
he needed Humphrey to do the finesse work.
Right.
And also to do stuff that the president couldn't do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just kind of what did he like? What kind of stuff do vice presidents do that presidents can't?
Well, this was when Humphrey was in the Senate, but then like when he was VP, you preside over the Senate, and really you can't do anything except preside over the Senate
and break ties
if there's a tying vote.
Yeah.
But basically Humphrey was going to use the vice presidency. He saw it as a way to get into the presidency, which he wanted for a long time.
Of course,
he almost was the nominee in '60 until the West Virginia. Primaries where Kennedy upset him.
Oh, okay.
And, that's where Harry Truman's joke about, Kennedy, whose dads can, who other's politicians' dads do you know can buy West Virginia? Because Humphrey should have won West Virginia, a Protestant running in West Virginia against the Catholic.
Yeah.
And Humphrey was a national figure already. When Kennedy upset him there in '60, it's what really made him go, I'm going to have to wait.
Oh, wow. That's crazy talk. And then, so Johnson doesn't run again. Right?
No, he decides, he makes that famous announcement in '68,
Vietnam.
With the Vietnam, I will not run again.
Yeah.
So that's what gets Humphrey the nomination as the sitting vice president.
Okay.
But he still had to fight off RFK, and if RFK hadn't been assassinated, Humphrey might not have gotten the nomination.
So he ran for president in '68.
In '68, the Democratic candidates were the vice president, Hubert Humphrey, Robert F. Kennedy, and the other senator, Humphrey's protege and former fellow senator from Minnesota, Eugene McCarthy.
Oh, okay.
And then RFK got assassinated, of course.
Right.
And
so
McCarthy bowed out, and Humphrey as the vice president, he had the most power and the most votes and the most national presence. So he won the nomination at the horrible Democratic National Convention of '68, where the riots happened in Chicago and everything, and all the beatings by cops of hippies and protesters. And,
right, and then all
that
of a sudden, Nixon.
Nightmare. Yeah, and all the Republicans were laughing at the '68 convention and enjoying watching the hippies get beat up, like Pat Buchanan said and everything.
Yeah.
It was horrible. The '68 convention, was just one of the worst examples of American politics in history.
Right. It was all kinds of trouble back then. It was, they have a better use of the media now where they don't show it.
But then it was just a nightmare. I mean, Dan Rather getting punched in the face, by a cop on the floor and everything
I never saw that footage.
Something like that.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a nightmare.
If
you were like, the '68 convention, it was the 40th anniversary of it back in 08.
Yeah.
And there were lots of articles and stuff about it. People talked with people who were there, like Gore Vidal and Pat Buchanan, watching it on TV and everything. It was awful.
Yeah.
And it embarrassed Humphrey so bad. And Johnson wouldn't endorse him because Humphrey wanted to, wheel back on the Vietnam stuff.
Right. And Johnson felt like it was a slap to his face.
And Johnson felt like it was a slap to his face. And the Democrats were so splintered. And Nixon used his Southern strategy, and Nixon won, which was awful.
Right.
Because just, 5 years later, Watergate, and he's forced to resign and everything.
Right.
It was
so
horrible.
Spiro Agnew resigned.
Yes.
Before
Nixon.
Before Nixon.
Yeah.
Why? What was – I don't even – I mean, I was a child, but I don't remember this.
The Agnew resignation had to do with bribes and stuff.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's a complicated, he was getting, 5% kickbacks from somebody or something like that. It was –
Really?
Yeah, it was – yeah. But,
it was documented?
Oh, yeah, it was documented, and Agnew resigned, and he later claimed, he'd been forced to resign, and he'd been threatened with, assassination and stuff like this. But he was just so full of shit. He was a horrible – the New York Times said, flat out, Spiro Agnew is not fit to be the second in line for the presidency of the United States.
Because he's a mess.
Oh, he was a mess. No, he was some writer said that the Nixon choosing Agnew was like when Caligula chose his horse to be consul.
That's a great line.
Yeah.
And
but it was awful. I mean, Nixon beating Humphrey in '68 is one of the worst presidential tragedy elections to ever happen.
Right.
Because Humphrey would have been amazing and would have spared, he would have wrapped up Vietnam shorter and faster, right. sparing thousands of lives.
And
tens of thousands of Vietnamese lives, American lives.
Yeah.
You know, and he wouldn't have had a Watergate.
Right. Right.
He was squeaky clean.
I think he would have been more like Herbert Hoover, where he would have been known as probably a guy that took the fall for Vietnam.
Well, I mean, we'll never know.
But he would have done it right.
Yeah, but I think he would have ended Vietnam much faster.
Yes.
And Nixon would have, he wouldn't have let it go to 72. He would have gotten it done like in his first year of the presidency, I think.
You think?
I honestly do, because he really wanted to wrap it up. He really hated Vietnam.
What did he end up doing in life? What was his post?
After he lost the 68 election,
yeah.
he kind of retired from politics a little bit and came back, and he taught here in Minneapolis at McAllister College some.
Okay.
And then he got reelected to the Senate.
Oh, okay.
And
to
so
the
he
US
had,
Senate.
Yeah, so he went back to the Senate and he served there. And he got, I think it was cancer of the bladder.
Oof.
And he passed away like in 77 or something like that, or
78. Oh, wow, so pretty quick.
Yeah, it was a shame. It was a real tragedy.
Right.
But he was back in the Senate. He got elected to the Senate again after leaving, you know, the vice presidency
yeah.
after the 68 election. I think he took some time off, and then he got elected to the Senate, and he served in the Senate.
It's interesting to go back into that level of politics after. I mean, because, you know, you think about, like, someone who's become president. What is there to do after that?
Right.
Right?
He'd done everything except become president. He'd been, you know, a
right.
mayor, a senator, a vice president. And he'd always dreamed of being president. It was very tragic.
The only thing – right. Well, the only – I remember John Taft. John Taft?
Bob Taft.
William Taft.
William Howard Taft or his son, Bob, Senator Bob Taft?
His president.
William Howard Taft. Yeah.
yeah. So he became Supreme Court.
Yes. He is the only man who's ever was president of the United States and Chief Justice of the Supreme Court.
Right.
Taft.
Did any of them do we have any other presidents or vice presidents who went to the Supreme Court not to just become
God, that's
Chief
a good
Justice?
Question.
Yeah. I can't think of it offhand.
I can't really think off the top of my head. I'm sure I think
it seems
possibly?
Like the only it seems but, like the only thing that's left, really.
Right.
If you want to make policy, if you want to affect change after you've been president of the United States, it's all that's really
yeah,
left.
Yeah, pretty much. Chief Justice is the last thing. Only
I mean,
Taft has been both
president. You can't go back to the Senate.
No. You can, like John Quincy Adams.
It's legal. But John Quincy, that's early days, though.
Yeah.
I feel like it isn't a 20th century thing.
It's not much of a 20th century thing. No.
I feel like
John Quincy Adams, after the election of 1826, I want to say, or something, mm-hmm. you know, he took some time off after he lost to Andrew Jackson, and then he went back and served in the Senate.
Okay.
Yeah,
I think you want to regroup after
yeah.
you've lost the presidency.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what
it's
about,
a tough thing.
Yeah. So what about Mondale? He's a
Mondale,
vice president.
Yeah. So that's
here.
What. So going into Humphrey, Mondale was his protege.
Okay.
And Mondale was chosen. He served in the Senate
mm-hmm.
with
also
Hubert
from Minnesota.
Humphrey, also from Minnesota, and tapped by Carter to be his VP nominee in
76.
And again, it was a kind of, you know, geographical balance because Carter was a Southern Democrat from
Georgia.
And was a governor.
Yeah.
And so you add a northern senator with international experience to balance your ticket.
That's right.
So you have Mondale,
yeah.
who'd been, you know, endorsed by Hubert Humphrey and other popular and prominent Democrats.
Okay.
And so that was it was a winning ticket, and they did win. Beat Ford.
And so how long was Mondale in the Senate before he?
I want to say he'd had like at least three terms, two or
okay.
three terms, but maybe two, maybe like Senate terms are so long, 6 years. I think I want to say at least two terms, like he was in the middle of his second or third term.
So middle '60s.
Something. Well, I think he was
like
a relatively younger man
yeah.
in those days. Like he was in his 50s. Like,
yeah.
I want to say late '40s, early '50s when he was elected. They were a young ticket, Carter and Mondale.
Yeah, it felt like a seriously young ticket.
Yeah, they were
when
a
I was
young.
A kid.
Oh yeah, they were a young ticket. They were a young ticket in general for any election.
Yeah.
And yeah, Carter and Mondale, there was a very great mood, and this is why Ford lost, of sweeping the bastards out, you know,
yes.
after the scandal of Watergate.
Yeah.
And Ford being appointed and him pardoning Nixon.
Yeah.
The nation was just sick of that kind of politics.
That's right. And who was Ford's Rockefeller?
Rockefeller was his VP.
Right.
And then he dropped him for Bob Dole.
Oh.
And Ford later said it was the biggest political mistake he ever made, losing Rockefeller. The hard right conservatives of the Republicans forced him to drop Rockefeller because they thought Rockefeller was too liberal.
Oh, right, because he had... Because
he was a New York, you know,
he was a New York Republican.
He was a very progressive Republican.
Yeah.
And he'd been a popular governor of New York.
Yeah.
And he'd done really well for himself. He was... and he'd been appointed...
So
Ford chose him
as
his VP.
Running mate.
He dropped Rockefeller for Bob Dole.
For the 76 election. Okay,
And they lost. Yeah. And Ford later said it was the biggest political mistake he ever made.
Wow.
Because Rockefeller could have made a difference in getting a lot of votes.
I think he could have, just because of the name recognition alone.
The name recognition and his policies. He was a liberal – he was a more liberal Republican.
Yeah.
It balanced the ticket better, especially the way the nation felt after Watergate and everything and after the Nixon pardon.
Right, right.
So losing Nelson Rockefeller – who, you know, has entered the zeitgeist recently because of, you know, the character on Mad Men working for him and mentioning him a lot and everything.
Right.
A lot of people are like Nelson Rockefeller, who's that? And,
And
he's become more popular recently because of all his name dropping, his name being dropped on Mad Men a lot. By,
right. Because nobody remembers
Henry,
that there was
Betty's
a Rockefeller
husband.
That's ever been in that level of national politics. But
yeah, I mean,
I
like there's senators from West Virginia, Nelson Rockefeller.
Yeah.
Well, he was, you know, first of all, obviously he was wildly wealthy.
Right. He wasn't living check to check.
No. He funded Citizen Kane, Nelson Rockefeller. He was that rich. Nelson Rockefeller was so rich.
How rich was he?
That he lived in a mansion of his own instead of the vice presidential mansion because his own mansion was nicer.
And he
donated his salary as vice president to charity. He didn't need it. He was so rich.
It's like Leno.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, Leno never touched any of his Tonight Show money.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. He lived off of stand-up money.
Wow.
And,
I had no
idea. Which is why he did corporates for $250,000 a pop so that they could live quite well.
Wow.
And then he gave all of his Tonight Show money to his wife for philanthropy.
I had no idea. Well, yeah. Rockefeller basically did the same thing. Like his salary as vice president was peanuts to him.
Yeah.
So he donated it to charity.
He's like, whatever.
Whatever.
Yeah.
And then after, like, you know, he was dropped from the ticket, obviously he was pissed off and bitter about it. And I think he just, like, kind of retired from politics.
And then
he famously died under very mysterious circumstances. Like,
oh, really?
Yes. He was found dead in his mansion. And when the police appeared on the scene, they noticed some inconsistencies and weird things, like that his shoes were on the wrong feet as he was slumped in his chair.
What?
That a newspaper that he had supposedly been reading was, like, I think, like, opened in a weird place or something, or upside down or something like that.
Reading the comics or something?
There were some weird circumstances in the scene.
Locked room mystery.
So they asked, you know, some people about it.
Yeah.
And it turned out that Rockefeller had been... with his younger mistress and her,
he
was in the sack. He died, I think, probably mid coitus with his 24-year-old mistress.
And
she called his aides, you know, and they came and rearranged the scene and covered it up.
Oh my God!
And the Rockefellers, of course, being so rich and powerful, you know, they did everything they could to cover it up for a while.
Yeah,
but it eventually leaked and everything.
Right, wrong shoes. That's the worst assistant ever.
Oh, they scrambled, you know, because she called the assistants, then she called the police and the ambulances and everything.
Right, and they were like, don't call anybody.
Here's like a former vice president of the United States, and he's had a heart attack while he's fucking...
Not his wife. Yes.
Big deal.
Yeah.
And so, like, it's pretty much 95% sure that, like, he died mid-sex with his, like, 20-something mistress.
Wow.
And then they rearranged all the death stuff, like, putting him in his chair and all that stuff.
I want to find out where, like, the thing is that had to mess with her sex life.
Oh,
the
I'm sure.
Rest of her life, she's just like...
Well, she got left her, like, about $500,000 or $50,000 to $500,000 in his will. So I think she was okay.
Right. She had dried her tears.
But her sex life was probably...
Yeah, well, that's the thing. There's some sexual healing that has to go on after you die. And he was... How old was he when he died?
Oh, I think he was in his 70s or something.
Oh, he
like
was
that.
Older?
He was much older than her, yeah.
Oof.
No doubt about it.
I have never needed money that bad. I don't know what people's lives... Kids! Out there, Grandma Cation wants to tell you, keep it together. Anyway, so Mondale.
Back to Mondale. Back to boring Mondale, who's never had sex with any 20-year-olds.
Right, never had sex at all.
He might die mid-coitus. We're not sure yet because he's still alive.
Yeah.
But so Mondale was Carter's VP.
Right.
And then, you know,
did he give stirring speeches in the...
He was not exactly the most if you've ever seen Walter Mondale speak, he's not the most electrifying
speaker. He just seems to be a good egg.
Yeah, he's just a regular nice guy for the most part, I thought.
Yeah.
But then he was, you know, and then he and Carter lost to Reagan in 80.
Yeah.
And then he, and then Mondale got the nomination in 84 and got stomped, got his ass kicked.
Handed to him as
He lost Reagan. Every state except here, Minnesota.
Except Minnesota.
He lost every state. He got his ass kicked.
Right.
And most younger people now know Mondale for getting his ass kicked in 84 and for all the references that they've dropped about him on, like, The Simpsons and Futurama and
right.
everything.
Don't they have his head in a jar in Futurama?
I think that was true, but, like, on The Simpsons, you know, I think it's the episode where Bart is going to be beaten by the Australians or something.
Yeah.
You know? Like, the ship that saves The Simpsons is the USS Walter Mondale, which is the Navy's laundry ship. And
yeah, it just feels like a slap. I mean, Mondale was a good guy, though, right?
He was a good guy. No, Mondale,
what is he doing now?
That's a good question. Mondale was a good guy, and then you asked about, like, we talked about, like, how, what do you do after you've been, like, vice president and nearly president? He had been ambassador to Japan.
Oh, okay.
And the Japanese just, like, worshipped him.
Okay.
And so he spends a lot of time here working at a law firm here in Minneapolis, like, okay, as a figurehead.
Right, right.
He doesn't really practice law very much.
Right.
And he goes to Japan sometimes in the winter. Like, he'll winter in Japan.
Just doing cons, just signing headshots.
I have no idea. But they, like, the Japanese were very honored that, like, a former vice president of the United States and all these things that he had held was appointed their ambassador. They were thrilled.
Well, that's neat.
So they treated him really nice. And then, so he lives there sometimes, he lives here sometimes, and we were supposed to interview him for Vice Presidents, the documentary.
Oh, that's right.
And then,
by the way, let me just tell people again that I am with Matt Saxe, S-A-X-E, and we're talking Vice Presidents, and you're on the Dork Forest, and it's super fun. But Vice Presidents, being number two in the White House,
yes,
is your documentary that you're working on with Jason Klum.
Yes, and we were supposed to interview him for it here. Like, I'd reached out to him, God, like in 2007, I reached out to him about it.
Okay.
And it took years to try and get, you know, through, like, you know, his secretary. And, you know, he'd be in Japan for times and he had medical issues.
Okay.
And finally, he agreed to do, like, an interview with us.
Okay.
And, you know, Jason and I put a fundraiser up on the vice president's blog and everything to raise money to help Jason fly out here so he could be here for it, obviously.
Right.
And I found a local crew from a film school.
Okay.
That was going to, like, do the shoot, and their students would work on it as interns, like, for an experience of it. Like, the instructor was, like, thrilled about it. He's like, gosh, this is going to be great for our students and everything like that. And it was all going to be volunteer, so we didn't have to pay for it and everything.
Right, right.
Because we'd use
You're
money.
You're trying to put this together.
Yeah, we're trying to put this together, and we're scrambling on a shoestring budget.
Right.
And
you are not Rockefellers.
No, we are not Rockefellers. We're not even, like, fifth cousin Rockefellers.
Right, you're not even Humphreys.
We're not even Humphreys, who is dirt poor, too. So we scrambled to put this together, and both Jason and I bought Mondale's book that had come out recently, and we read it.
Yep.
It was very dry, boring reading, but, you know, I wanted to be really prepared.
Yeah.
I worked really hard on preparing my questions and everything. I was like, this is going to be it. This is going to a two-hour interview with the former vice president of the United States and everything. This is going to be amazing.
Right.
So I think about, like, a couple days before we were supposed to do the interview, I'm at my office at this new job I'd just gotten, and I get a call. I check my voicemail, and, like, there's a message from the law office that he works for, like, Mr. Mondale wants to speak with you.
Okay.
So I get my cell phone, and I go out to the, like, parking lot behind the office, and I call the number, and I'm like, this is Matt Saxe. I was told to call to speak with Mr. Mondale, and this woman says, hold for the vice president, and then I'm on the phone with him.
Wow.
Yeah. And then he starts peppering me with questions. He's like,
oh, like, what's it going to be like?
What's this going to be like?
Yeah.
What is this? I'm looking at this, and
Did you say, what do you want it to be?
Here's the thing. Like, I wish I'd said something almost like that.
Yeah.
But I was trying to be super polite because, like, obviously I'm nervous.
Yeah.
Like, here I am behind, like, this, in this parking lot outside talking with the former vice president of the United States and Democratic nominee for president of the United States.
Uh-huh.
And I'm like, oh my God, I don't want to say anything that's going to be wrong or offensive. So I'm like, he said, first
that
thing.
That guy's met Khrushchev.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This guy is like, you know, amazing. So I'm on the phone. So I say to him, like, well, Mr. Vice President, you know, and then he says, like, I think he said, like, call me Fritz or something like that.
Okay.
And I'm like, okay. No. I'm like, well, you know, he hung on the word. He'd seen like the word comedic in our like, you know, all these letters and correspondence we'd sent. And then he's like, do you think the vice presidency is funny? And I'm like, no, sir. No, this is going to be a serious interview. Like when I interviewed Gore Vidal for our documentary, this is going to be a serious interview about, you know, what you think the role of the vice presidency is.
Yeah.
Your relationship and history with Hubert Humphrey, who was his mentor and everything.
Right.
And your experience in office as vice president. And
yeah.
Your observations. He's like, yeah, but I'm seeing this word comedic and it's just, it bothers me.
Freaking him out.
Oh, it's freaking him out. And he's like, before I can get answers out, he's hitting me with another question.
Yeah.
Like he's the lawyer prosecutor in him is out and he's like, bam, 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 hitting me. And I just can't answer his questions fast enough.
Yeah.
And then I scramble and I fluster and I go, you know, like I say like, well, you know, Mr. Vice President, some people have said that the vice presidency is an absurd office. And he's like, oh, you think the vice presidency is absurd? I'm like, no, sir, I don't think that.
Yeah.
I don't. People have said that. And this film is called comedic just because, you know, it's a Hollywood and you have to be able to sell it. You know, stupid studio executives want to hear comedy or drama. They don't want to hear like one, like a mix of it.
Right.
And he's like, No. And I'm like, sir, you know, even in, I said something to like the effect of, you know, sir, even in Ken Burns' Civil War, there are moments of levity. There are moments of, you know, to, you know, of jokes and stuff, just to, you know, funny anecdotes and things to like, you know, ease up the tension. But this interview with you, I want to be serious. I want it to be a serious examination of the vice presidency.
You're just digging a hole. Just
but
digging
he,
and digging.
Yeah, I'm
and
trying to save myself, but I can feel it slipping away.
He's gone.
And then he hangs up on me mid-sentence.
Yeah, you're done.
And he wouldn't take my calls, and that was it.
And that
I had
was
to
it.
Call Jason and tell him, like, Jason, something horrible has happened.
Yes.
I had to call the crew and, like, tell
cancel
them it wasn't.
Everything.
This was like 2 days. The Jason was going to fly out, I think, the next day from L.A. to Minneapolis.
I will say this about the job of vice president is that it lends itself to thinking that you're a failure.
Right. Or to be mocked.
When you are not.
When you're not, no.
The fact that you're number two might, you know, I mean, I could see where a guy like Lyndon Johnson would be an asshole about it.
Yeah.
But
he hated being vice president,
but
by the way.
Everyone else is like, that's amazing.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I'm more Japanese, I guess, than Lyndon Johnson. And so I forgot that Lyndon Johnson was a vice president.
Oh, yeah. He was Kennedy's VP, but he hated it.
Oh, that's right. I didn't forget that. I just spaced that. Okay. Yeah.
No, I mean, for some, I think Jason talked about this. Like, the vice presidency is what you make of it.
Yeah.
And Humphrey had used it as best he could. Mondale, when he was vice president, became a powerful part of the government. He elevated the vice presidency higher.
That's right. Jason said that.
That's exactly right.
Because previously, there was no real position internationally as a vice president. But Mondale created that.
Mondale is who elevated and made the vice presidency what it is today.
With the encouragement and of Jimmy Carter?
Oh, yeah. President Carter needed him to do this because, like, Carter was a governor from Georgia. He had no experience in Washington.
That's
he had very tiny bits of international experience, barely any.
Right.
Mondale was an internationalist.
Mm-hmm.
He'd been trained by, you know, Humphrey. He'd been in the Senate. He dealt with foreign policy.
Right.
He's a very astute, wise foreign policymaker and diplomat.
Oof.
And without Mondale is who led, you know, the experience and international credence to the Carter-Mondale ticket.
Right, and Mondale into the job.
And into the job. And so when they got elected, immediately Carter was like, I need you to like head up all these foreign departments. I need you to be my man on international diplomacy.
Right.
And Mondale made his own job, basically. He's like, well, I'll do this, and I'll do that, and I'll do this, and I'll do that.
Okay.
And it made it into a powerful vice presidency that future vice presidents like Gore and Cheney and now Vice President
and
Biden
Bush?
Have followed.
Okay.
Bush not so much because Reagan kind of shut him out a little bit.
Did he?
Yeah, a little bit.
Because you would have thought Reagan would have needed him.
Oh, he needed him, but he didn't use
him correctly.
He didn't. I don't think Reagan used Bush as much as he could have.
Yeah.
They had kind of an antagonistic relationship, despite what, you know, the former President Bush would say. You know, he didn't like losing to Reagan in the Republican primaries. And
well, I can't imagine. I mean, Ronald Reagan is, to some extent, just such a figure.
Yeah.
Just a figurehead.
Yeah.
And
he's become a romanticized figure.
He's been
romanticized
by the right.
Yeah.
And I was there. I was there. I might not be super young, you guys. And I hated him. Hated him with the power of the sun.
Mm-hmm.
He was a mess.
Right.
But Bush, it was funny because I didn't like Bush either because he was the head of the CIA.
Yes, he'd been head of the CIA.
And I was like, But the fact that, that Reagan didn't use him correctly was one of the greatest things about their presidency.
Yeah.
Because he could have done, he did a great deal of damage, but he could have done a great deal more.
Right.
And then Bush came to power anyway.
Yeah. So. Well, I mean, no sitting vice president who's ever declared themselves the candidate for president mm-hmm. for their party has lost. If you're VP and you decide to run for president out and out mm-hmm. and you declare yourself for the nomination and you campaign and all in the primaries, you'll win. That has been proven. Well, you'll win the nomination. You might not okay. win the presidency, but you'll win the party's nomination at least.
Okay. Okay. Oh, that's sort of a rule of thumb.
Sitting vice president has decided to be president, has run for the nomination of the party and for the presidential nomination, they've gotten it. They have not all won.
Right. Who has decided not to? Who said, you know,
well, lots of VPs just have decided not to run for, they just couldn't, they knew they weren't going to get the votes or the party endorsement and everything.
Okay.
Almost all of them.
Right. So
it'd be easier, I'm trying to rack my brain, it'd be easier to list the ones who have gotten the nomination than the ones who haven't.
Who has, do me a favor as best you can in some sort of order the ones who did.
Well, Martin Van Buren, Andrew Jackson's second vice president,
okay.
He got the nomination and won the presidency.
Right.
In 1826 or 1828 or something like that.
Okay.
And then I'm trying to think.
Was Polk ever vice president?
No. Okay. That's Van Buren, and then it goes all the way, I think it wouldn't be until, it wouldn't be until the 40s or 50s. I'm racking my brain here.
Right.
Then George W. Bush got it. You know, he was Reagan's vice president, got the nomination and won.
Right.
Hubert Humphrey was the Democratic, he was the Democratic nominee.
Yep.
He just lost.
Yeah.
But he won the party's nomination for president.
Yeah.
So those are three examples. Van Buren won and Bush won and Humphrey lost.
Now I'm gonna,
and Al Gore.
And Al Gore.
He was vice president and he lost.
And using you as a trivia book at this point, because now I'm just curious. I guess I can't remember. Who was Ulysses S. Grant's vice president?
His first one was Schuyler Colfax.
Schuyler. That's right, because he had the greatest name in the world.
Yeah.
Schuyler Colfax.
Colfax, yeah.
Do you know about him?
Well, if you've seen the movie Lincoln... The guy who's...
I saw Abraham Lincoln and Vampire Hunter.
Ah, okay.
Different movie entirely.
Different movie. If you saw the movie Lincoln, you know, a lot of it takes place in the House of Representatives about ratifying the constitutional amendment to free the slaves and everything. The guy who's the Speaker of the House in that movie, who's presiding all over the House hearings, that's Speaker Colfax.
Oh, okay.
He was the Speaker of the House when Lincoln was president.
Okay.
And so that's that guy. So when you watch Lincoln, it's that guy.
Okay.
And he was from... I want to say he was from Ohio.
Okay.
And Lincoln called him like a charming rascal, a smiling little intriguer who was plausible and not to be trusted.
Fantastic.
Yeah. And Colfax met with Lincoln on the day of his assassination. He was like the last meeting the president had was with Colfax, the Speaker of the House. That was his last like official meeting of the day before he left for Ford's Theater.
Yes.
So Colfax was one of the last people to see Lincoln alive.
Wow.
And then he was Grant's vice president, and he was forced to resign due to, like, a scandal. He'd taken, like, some bribes or something like that.
Okay.
And then he – and again, a Minnesota connection. Colfax was here in Minnesota. His train broke down, and he had to walk about, like, a quarter of a mile in the snow up in Mankato.
Oh, wow.
And it killed him. He had a heart attack and died.
Well, yeah. You know, you think about my knee-jerk reaction was a quarter of a mile, and then I was like, oh, it's 1870.
Yeah, in the raging snowstorm.
In a raging snowstorm.
And he was a man
Mankato.
Of, like, in his 60s, yeah.
And he's in his 60s. He's probably wearing some sort of weirdo boot.
Oh, yeah.
And the snow in Minnesota is no joke now.
It was a blizzard. It was a no joke now. It was a blizzard. Like, the train, that's why the train broke down. You know, the snow was so bad, it broke down, and
so
he had to walk.
So he just died of exposure
And heart failure.
Wow.
And the cold. It all killed him.
Good Lord.
Yeah.
Okay. So who was the next one?
This is where I get like, this is, Grant
it gets
had,
muddy.
Grant had two vice presidents because he had two terms. Colfax was forced to resign. And then I think his next one was, it was Henry Wilson
who Jason liked.
It was Henry Wilson because after the Colfax scandal, they needed someone squeaky clean.
Okay.
And Wilson was very squeaky clean.
Okay.
He'd returned the stock of the Credit Mobiler scandal that had stirred up that it forced Colfax and other people to resign and expose them.
Right.
And he'd bought it with, like, some money that had been given to his wife. And it was very convoluted. But basically everyone was like, well, it's Henry Wilson who's squeaky clean, who's helped fight, who was an abolitionist and helped free the slaves, and who was a honest, noble man.
He was in the war.
He wasn't in the war. He was in the Senate.
Okay.
But he was a very big, strong abolitionist and a very powerful person to push for. He drove Lincoln kind of crazy, kind of bugging him. He would always come and bug him at the White House about freeing the slaves. Lincoln found him very passionate and inspiring, but at the same time, very annoying.
Right.
But Wilson was who was replaced Colfax, because Colfax had been, you know, so scandalous that they brought in Wilson to replace him. And Wilson, like Jason said, very impressive figure. You know, his dad had sold him into indentured servitude.
Oh, that's right. He was the Horatio Alger.
Yeah, he was the basis pretty much for Horatio Alger.
Right.
And Horatio Alger was from his hometown of Natick, Massachusetts.
Okay.
And the Wilson thing, like Jason touched a lot about Wilson. Wilson's dad named him after a rich man in town to try and imply that he was the bastard son of that rich man so he could blackmail him.
Okay.
But it didn't work.
Wow.
That's what kind of horrible dad Wilson had.
Yeah.
Then Wilson's dad sold his son into indentured servitude.
Right.
And then Wilson...
So that he could go buy a beer, no doubt.
Right. His real name was not Henry Wilson. It was Jeremiah Jones Colbath.
Okay.
Jeremiah Jones was the rich man who his father tried to blackmail.
Ah.
And so
Henry Wilson was like,
Henry Wilson changed his name to Henry Wilson to totally distance himself from his horrible father.
Right.
And after being an indentured servant, which was basically a white slave.
Yeah.
In this shoe factory.
Yep.
He learned everything about shoemaking and shoes and running a business and opened his own shoe factory and became a millionaire.
Right. Right.
And then he ran for
the
Senate.
Because he was a white man.
Yeah.
And
then he ran for the Senate and pushed for workers' rights and unionism and for abolition, for freeing the slaves.
Okay.
He was really a noble, inspiring figure.
That is very – and then he did not run for president.
He died, I think, too, in office. Or, like, he died after the Grant administration or near the end of the Grant administration.
All right.
But he would have – he was a very squeaky, clean guy.
Yeah.
But Colfax was not, so.
Right, so no loss.
No loss.
What were who were a couple of your other favorite VPs?
Oh, that's a great question. Like Jason, I'm a big admirer of Aaron Burr, who I think is one of the most fascinating figures in all of American history.
Yeah.
And had so many admirable attributes.
Yeah. And got sucker punched repeatedly.
Oh, yeah. He's been beaten into the ground by history. I mean, right now he's being beaten in, not Ben Franklin, but he's but by Hamilton supporters and people like that. But I mean, even now, Aaron Burr is taking a beating on Broadway in the Hamilton musical.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I mean, that musical.
As we speak, singing some shitty song about Aaron Burr.
As we speak, Aaron Burr is getting made to look like a villain on Broadway in Hamilton the musical. Maybe not an out-and-out villain, because Lin-Manuel Miranda, who wrote the musical and is playing Hamilton in it, you know, he doesn't flat-out make him horrible.
Okay.
But at the same time, because he thought about playing Burr himself before he finally decided to play Hamilton.
What's the story about Hamilton?
Oh,
Hamilton's a dirtbag.
Yeah, well, yeah, but at the same time, brilliant. I don't deny it.
No. The thing is I have tolerated many a very funny asshole in my life.
Yes.
So I know that someone who is incredibly smart.
Oh yeah.
Smartest guy in the room often.
Yeah.
Can also be the biggest jack, like Lyndon Johnson.
Yeah. Hamilton was the smartest guy in the room almost every time, but he was corrupt and
brutal.
And brutally and vicious in his politics and
spiteful. And childish in many ways.
And an adulterer and these things. But no doubt a financial genius.
Financial genius.
Very brave in the Revolutionary War. I'm not a big Hamilton supporter, but I don't deny it.
What was his war record?
His war record was exceptional. He was Washington's aide-de-camp.
Oh, really?
And then he helped fight helped win at Yorktown.
Oh, wow.
He was one of the lead...
strategist guys?
No, he fought in the field at Yorktown.
He fought at... Why would George Washington's aide-de-camp fight?
He wanted to get out and get some combat experience. He was tired of people saying he was hiding behind the lines.
Well,
he went out in Yorktown and helped go, like, do some of the trench warfare. Because Yorktown was a siege, basically. You know, like, they dug in and blew away at Cornwallis from the land while the French blew away at him from sea and hemmed him between them, battered him into submission.
Mm-hmm.
But Hamilton was part of he helped advance on Yorktown and led sorties and attacks and everything like that. He might have even gotten into some hand-to-hand combat with his sword during it. I'm not 100% sure. But he had a good war record.
Okay.
And then he went
but
to
he
the
just wanted to make sure that he was...
He wanted to make sure he got some military glory.
Right, so that he didn't ever get called on as saying...
No, no one wanted him... He didn't want to be called a coward.
Right, because he probably wanted to run for office.
Yeah. he was as ambitious as Lucifer. There's no denying it.
Yes, yes.
And
so what's the play about?
The Hamilton the musical is based on Ron Chernow's famous biography of Hamilton, probably the definitive best biography ever written of Hamilton. Chernow is a very big detractor of Burr.
Okay.
He does not think much of Aaron Burr. And so like Manuel Miranda has said, like most Burr books are like, you know, defensive things about Burr. But if you look at Burr and Hamilton, Burr had just as good a war record, if not better.
Yeah.
Burr fought in the invasion of Quebec.
Okay.
Where he famously, like when the commanding officer in charge of the attack on the city was blown apart by like grape shot and cannon fire, Burr tried to pick up his body and drag it back from the lines. It was a horrifying battle, the Battle of Quebec. Like I think it was on New Year's Day in the middle of a snowstorm.
Good Lord.
And
heard of that.
Oh, yeah. Well, America.
My Revolutionary War history is not that great.
Yeah. Well, one of the strategies of the Continental Congress was to invade Canada.
Okay.
And so, like, and I can't remember the general off the top of my head who was in charge of it, but Benedict Arnold was part of it, Aaron Burr was part of it, and this other general was part of it, and they marched through all sorts of horrible forests and everything from New York or something all the way up to Quebec through forest, through rain. They had to kill dogs and eat them. It was snow. It was nightmarish.
Right.
Hell. It was like a hell
was
march.
Was it that winter that we all learn about when we're kids?
Not like, the Valley Forge winter.
The Valley Forge winter?
A couple years before that.
Okay.
But Burr was at Valley Forge too.
Oh, was he?
Yeah. Hamilton and Burr were both at Valley Forge.
Oh, okay.
They marched all the way to Quebec and like the day, I think like the next day was when the term of enlistment was up.
Okay.
So they had to attack. They attacked.
So they had to use all the troops that they could.
Otherwise, they were all just going to turn around and go home.
Oh, my God.
So they launched the attack. It failed. It came not terrible. It didn't fail too awfully. They got through the outside things of the city, and they were putting – I think they were like getting to the point where they were going to put ladders on the walls to try and scale the walls.
So they broke through some of the lines?
They broke through some lines, but – yeah, they still lost.
Okay.
And they had to retreat. And Burr's commanding officer, and I wish I could remember his name because he's a forgotten American hero.
Okay.
He was blown apart.
Mm-hmm. And Burr tried to save.
Burr tried to pick up his body and drag it. But Burr was a little kind of guy, and this guy was a big, like over 6 foot tall, 200-pound man.
Okay.
And in the raging snowstorm and being shot at and everything, he couldn't get his body up and drag him all the way behind the line, so he had to abandon him on the field.
Right.
There were paintings made of this, and it was a famous incident.
Okay.
And Burr was like, I think Burr became a national hero because of it.
Okay.
Because he fought so bravely at Quebec and tried to save his commanding officer's corpse and everything. And so he got appointed to General Washington's staff. Washington didn't trust him exactly. And Burr did not endear himself to it. And he didn't want to be on the staff. He wanted to be in the field.
Okay.
So he was assigned to be General Israel Putnam's like second in command, aide de camp.
Okay.
And he basically, because Putnam was not the brightest of guys, Burr basically ran it. And okay. Burr did all sorts of things to run the British out of New York and New Jersey. He led all sorts of raids and everything. Mm-hmm. And then he trained troops at Valley Forge.
Okay.
Where he supposedly the famous arm cutting off incident happened, where like some of his men were sick of him ordering them around in the way he was. So like they were going to have a rebellion against him, and he was informed about it. And a guy who was leading the attack said, "Now is your time, boys," and tried to shoot him. And Burr whirled around with his saber and cut his arm off.
Oh, my God.
That supposedly happened.
But it could be anecdotal.
It could be anecdotal.
Mm-hmm.
It's become shrouded in myth. Some people say it happened.
Okay.
Some people said it didn't. Like Gore Vidal has it in Burr.
Yeah.
And I brought it up to him while I was interviewing him.
Yeah.
And then he went back and said, "No, that never happened." And I said, "But it's in your book." And he said, "No, it's not." He snapped at me. And I was like, "Oh, okay."
Yeah, yeah.
Don't argue with Gore Vidal.
Right.
In his house. But he has it in the book happening.
Yeah.
But it's disputed. Like, some people say it's true. Some people, it's shrouded
it
in myth.
It makes for a good story.
But it makes for a hell of a good story.
Right. Yeah. There's no reason for Gore Vidal not to have put it in the book.
Right.
Because it's fictional. It's historical fiction.
Yes.
And I know Gore Vidal probably thinks that he's a historian, but he's a
novelist.
He's a novelist.
Yeah, and an essayist.
Right.
Probably the greatest American essayist of all time.
Doesn't mean that he isn't a good researcher. And a wonderful, and could be a powerful historian.
Oh, he had brilliant I mean, he was a historian, like, in the amateur historian style.
Yeah.
Did you
ever read any of Sarah Vowell's stuff?
Oh, yeah. I love Sarah Vowell.
Talk about amateur historians.
Yeah. No, I've read Assassination Vacation and Unfamiliar Fishes. I went to a book signing here for her for Unfamiliar Fishes and everything.
My brother last night was telling the story about how he went to hear her speak at a signing. Mm-hmm. And he had recently broken up with his girlfriend, and he was thinking, well, maybe she'll like me. And I said, you know, I'm in love with her from afar. And I was like, well, I'm really glad you didn't get to talk to her.
Yeah,
and
I got to talk to her.
Yeah, I think he got her to sign the book, but
she signed
mine
too. Yeah.
Yeah, he said I chickened out. I said, good, Phil, good for you. And it was gutsy stuff, my brother. And he's willing to go there.
Yeah,
and he's a guy who I asked him last night, by the way, if there was anywhere in the world that he could travel to. You know, like if he could take a trip anywhere. He was like, well, Montana and Canada. And I was like, what? You've been to both of those.
Yeah.
Those are attainable goals. I'm talking about Iceland.
Australia, New Zealand. Go to Middle Earth.
The moon.
Yeah.
Middle Earth.
Yeah, Middle Earth.
He's a Lord of the Rings guy for sure.
Yeah, why wouldn't he want to go to New Zealand and see Middle Earth and like go to Hobbiton and all that?
Yeah.
That would be awesome.
That would be awesome. And I will ask him about it tonight.
Or go to Hogwarts.
Don't even. He's a big fisherman, and he's like, no, I'm going to take my float tube and drive across Canada. And I said, yeah, but you're going to do that. And what I'm saying is, yes, go to New Zealand. That's a great
–
now I can just go to him. I was like, you don't want to go see Hobbiton?
Yeah.
Because he would.
You don't want to go see, like, the actual Pelennor Fields and everything?
Yes. Oh, my God. And see where Eowyn, you know,
oh, don't you want to see where Eowyn slew the Witch King of Angmar?
Yes. Yeah. Laughed in his
face. You got to do that.
I am no man.
Oh.
And anyway, so good. I like to weed off around minute 50.
Sure.
Into the Lord of the Rings. Why not?
Yeah.
So, well, that's cool. Who do you think... Who do you think's going to win the next one? Who do you think's
presidential election?
Yeah, and vice president.
Oh, well.
Who are the vice presidential candidates that you think are out there?
Boy, there's 16 Republican nominees.
Right.
So who the hell knows who they're going to choose?
And how many?
Probably won't choose a fellow nominee, though, because like if you saw, you know, Romney chose Ryan, who wasn't a candidate.
Right.
They'll probably pick somebody who's not a nominee, but I mean,
just it's usually a lateral move,
when you pick a VP, you want to pick somebody who won't outshine you.
Right.
And who's like maybe a younger up and comer. Like, as you see, like Mitt Romney choosing Paul Ryan, mm-hmm. even H.W. Bush picking freaking Dan Quayle.
Right.
You know, over Bob Dole or somebody like that.
Yeah, what do you know about Dan Quayle?
Oh, what don't people know about Dan Quayle? Jesus.
I don't know anything about Dan Quayle because I don't like Dan.
God.
Is he from Indiana?
He's from Indiana, the home of the vice presidents. You know, Indiana is where more vice presidents come from Indiana. It's the mother of vice presidents. It's where the vice presidential museum is. It's where
they've had the most vice presidents?
They've had the most vice presidents, Indiana.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Indiana is the home of the vice presidents.
Okay.
And Dan
Quayle. That's where he's from.
That's where he's from. That's where the Vice Presidential Museum and Dan Quayle Library are.
Or does Indiana have any presidents?
I don't. William Henry Harrison, technically.
Okay.
He was born in Virginia, but he was governor of Indiana Territory when he was elected president.
Okay.
So technically, William Henry Harrison.
Who was only president for, what, 30 days?
31 days or something like that.
Something like that, and then died of the cold.
Died of the cold, yep.
Yeah, that's him.
Yep.
Okay. Orson Scott Card.
Lots of VPs.
Anyway.
But lots of VPs from Indiana.
So Dan Quayle, born and raised in Indiana.
Oh, yeah, by his rich daddy. You know, kept out of Vietnam by his rich daddy.
Oh, that's right. He was one of the
National Guard.
Guys.
Oh, he's a big draft dodger, yeah.
Yeah.
And then, you know, all the mistakes, all the, you know, the spelling bee potato error,
right.
The argument with Murphy Brown, you know, arguing with a fictional character about her illegitimate baby, you know, just a debacle. And of course, the vice presidential debates in the election of 88.
Where did he go to
college? Jack Kennedy.
Yeah, that You're No Jack Kennedy is famous
for Lloyd Benson ripping him apart.
Yep.
Oh, man.
Yeah,
Lloyd Benson, right. Lloyd Benson.
And
who was a descendant of Henry Wilson.
Oh, weird.
I think so, yeah. I'm pretty sure about that.
Did you read The Wordy Shipmates?
Yes! The Wordy Shipmates?
That's Sarah Vaughan.
No, I read Unfamiliar Fishes and Assassination Vacation. I haven't read all of Wordy Shipmates yet.
Well, that's because it's dense. I recommend the Audible. Anyway, I'm calling an Audible on that.
Yeah.
And listening to Sarah Vaughan read it is much more interesting. But it's fascinating because there are two founders of Massachusetts who are their descendants, John Kerry and George W. Bush.
Wow.
and George W. Bush's ancestor, whatever, founding mother, mm-hmm. was a woman who was accused of witchcraft and
oh
went
God.
To Rhode Island and helped found
I think I've heard
Rhode
of that.
Island.
Yeah, for religious, you know, she left Rhode Island for yeah, religious freedom was, under Roger Williams' plan and everything.
Yes, and then John Kerry's great-great-great-great-grandfather or whatever was Bossy Magoo. He was the bossiest of all governors.
Was that his official name, Bossy Magoo?
Bossy
his
Magoo,
Christian
he
name?
It was his puritanical
That's a pretty
name.
Puritanical name.
It is pretty. He was no. the bossiest of all Magoos.
Yeah.
But he also wrote the Sermon on the Rock. He wrote the City on a Rock.
City on a Shining Hill.
Sermon.
Yeah.
Yeah, he wrote
famous
that.
Famous sermon, yeah.
Yeah. Williams? No, that was Roger Williams.
Yeah, Roger Williams founded Rhode Island. I forget who wrote the Shining City on a Hill
Which I've heard the book at least twice. Can't remember it.
I can't remember off the top of my head.
Everybody, Google it. Sittle on it.
Aaron, as opposed to Aaron Burr's grandfather, Jonathan Edwards, who wrote the famous Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God sermon and everything, who founded Princeton University.
Right, right.
Yeah.
I don't remember that. I remember reference to that.
Oh, it's like you're nothing more than a loathsome spider held over the flame.
Right, it was super grumpy.
It has all this
grumpy.
Hellish imagery in it.
Yeah, yeah, it was the grumpiest of all Christianity.
It's a very frightening, you know,
yeah, yeah.
image of hell. You know, you're nothing more than a loathsome spider hanging over the flames of hell. That is what you are to your creator.
Wow.
And stuff like that. Yeah. Very. Jonathan Edwards, very powerful
Christian
imagery. Fantastic.
That is the God that I want to follow. That's the one I want to believe in. The one that thinks I'm a spider over a
loathsome spider. Not just any spider. You're a loathsome spider.
Exactly. So how, let's talk, by the way, you guys, you should know in your hearts that I'm talking to Matthew Saxe, S-A-X-E, and it's @VPMattSaxe on the Twitter. And shadowhorsetheater.com, all bunch of links to that, to like a drinking game Minnesota.
Yep.
What is that?
Oh, it's an offshoot of the Los Angeles drinking game show where actors read a film script live on stage, and we throw in props and costumes and music, and there's drinking cues for. It's classic, you know, 80s and 90s scripts and stuff like that. We did Jaws just in July.
Okay.
For
and
summer movie
drinking?
Season, and there's drinking cues for the actors on stage and for the audience.
Shots and beers kind of situation?
Shots will kill you because we put in all these cues for it. Beer, it's mostly sipping beer and cocktails and stuff like that.
And so by the end of it, everybody's happy.
By the time everyone's wasted, yeah.
Oh my God, that's hilarious.
If you're not watching it, if you're not watching yourself. And there's videos of it on YouTube from our shows here in Minnesota where we've had, like, we did Back to the Future and we had Harry Waters Jr. who played your cousin Marvin Barry in our show.
Okay.
We did Fargo and we had the actress who played the whore that Steve Buscemi is having sex with when he gets attacked, who runs down the hallway naked
she,
and everything.
She was in it.
It's a really fun time.
Those are really fun. I love those kinds of shows with scripts and stuff. There was a guy, and I'm spacing his name, even though he gave me an XLR cable, Rangers. He gave me an XLR cable. he wrote Imaginary Episodes. It's a podcast, short-lived. I think he did maybe 15 episodes.
Okay.
And what he would do is he would write new scripts for old sitcoms.
Oh.
And I did Married with Children and Golden Girls.
Oh.
And those were two that I did.
It's like writing a spec script almost.
It's like writing a spec script, but... And they were truncated a little bit. They were shorter.
Sure.
But I always wanted them to write a Barney Miller episode, but he had never seen Barney Miller.
Oh.
And I was like, well, you're missing out because it's one of the greatest sitcoms ever made.
It's an underrated, forgotten sitcom.
It is on this TV all the time. I don't know. We don't have cable. We have a rabbit ear.
Sure.
So, but I have to say that people should definitely, if they get a chance in Minnesota, go to the Shadow Horse Theater.
Yes, please.
And come and see. You also have an improv troupe called Last Action Movie.
Last Action Movie, yeah.
Is the name of the troupe.
Yes.
And
we've toured. We've done the Chicago Improv Festival and the Spontaneous Combustion Festival in Atlanta. So sometimes you can see us out of town, but mostly we're based here.
Matt, this has been fascinating.
Thank you.
Jason Klum, thank you so much for saying,
thank you
should
you,
have Matt on. I made a Pez dispenser out of Legos. Anyway, and I said Legos plural, and it's Lego singular.
Oh,
so thanks
that's
a lot. It is important. So, Matt, thanks a lot for being on the show.
Thank you. It's been awesome. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rangers, for listening out there, and be nice to each other. You know the rules. Take care. Bye.
My hat, my hat, my hat. They're dancing around my hat. My hat, my hat, my hat. Well, what do you think of that? If it looks like a Mexican hat dance and it sounds like a Mexican hat dance, it's most likely a Mexican hat dance. So take off your hat and let's dance.
Yay! Oh, my God. Thank you. Why don't we just call that as the end of the show?